Bob, really nice to see you again.
Good to be back, Andrew.
Really nice shirt, by the way.
This is my space shirt. Right?
This is my space tie.
Hey, we match.
We kind of match. We had Branson, Bezos, Shatner going up. I mean, SpaceX, big in the news. I get, in a way, why it's important, right? Incremental baby steps for mankind. But you tell me, I mean, what's the big deal here?
Well, first of all, I counted 25 tourists went up this year. That's astounding. We've never had that many ordinary people go up into space before. And right now, it's rich people and their toys. I mean, that's what they are. If we can get more people doing it and the price comes down, then more ordinary people can go up and have the William Shatner experience. He broke down in tears when he came back because he saw the atmosphere of the Earth as being very, very thin, a thin line. He went, wow, we all live in that. And there's this thin blue line and then the deadly blackness of space. And he was overwhelmed by that. Well, that's good environmental awareness. And going into space does that. You know, everybody goes up to get what they call the overview effect. So the more people that can do that, the better, as far as I'm concerned. So space tourism right now is where the airline industry was when it first started. Only rich people could fly. More people did it. It becomes a bigger business. More people can have access to space. So we'll see what happens.
When it comes to space tourism, even space exploration, I feel like this year has been a little different from past years, where there's been a lot of blowback, right? A lot of people who've kind of openly wondered this question, okay, you know, the space, the tech is neat, the blast-offs are cool, but aren't there more important earthly pursuits that we ought to be prioritizing, right, and ought to be dealing with? It does feel different, right?
Yes, it does, and you're absolutely right. We should be prioritizing our attention towards the Earth. But in fact, Andrew, that's exactly what space does. It looks at the Earth. You know, back in my day in the 60s, when I was watching the moon missions, the very first mission to the moon, Apollo 8 in 1968, they didn't land, they just went around the moon. First time humans left the Earth and went to another heavenly body. And while they were there, they took that famous Earthrise picture, you know, the blue marble above the Earth.
Yeah.
It is no coincidence to me that after humanity saw itself as one very small little ball, and the guy who took that picture, Bill Andrews, I actually met him. He said, you know, you could hide the Earth behind your thumb from the moon. It's behind your thumb, and all you see is this blackness. Right after that, the Environmental Protection Agency came along, Earth Day came along, Environment Canada came along. People became aware, wow, this is it. There's only one environment. And since then, our space program has sent up satellites that look down on the planet to give us that broad view. And it was satellites that saw the ozone hole. Satellites are weather. Every night, you know, you do the weather. What do you get? You get a satellite view looking at, here's the latest hurricane coming this way. Here's the ocean currents that are shifting. We're watching the ice disappear in the Arctic. That's all happening from above. So the satellites, the space program is giving us a picture on ourselves that we can't get from the ground. And so I think it's vital that we do that. But let me give you another perspective, Andrew, on how much space actually costs us. Here in Canada, if you divide the budget of the Canadian Space Agency to the population of Canada, it's less than $10 per year.
Hmm.
$10 per year. You're going to be spending more on Christmas presents than you do on the space agency.
That's true.
So it's not hugely expensive to be up there. If you want to pick on other places where we could find money to take care of the Earth, don't pick on space, because we actually need space.
Whatever happened to the NASA DART mission? This was a mission to, correct me if I'm wrong, it was to essentially slam something into an asteroid in order
right.
to try to change its trajectory.
Right.
Finish the story.
Well, it's on its way. Now, I know there was a movie made up, you know, with Bruce Willis where they go and they blow the thing up.
That's right.
You don't want to do that. Because if an asteroid's coming to us and we blow it up, now we got 1,000 asteroids coming at us like buckshot. You don't want that. What you want to do is just nudge it just a little bit. Because if you catch it far enough away, the Earth is a pretty small target. So you just nudge it out so that it'll go by us and not hit us. So that's what the DART mission is about. See if we can just nudge an asteroid. Can you do it? Or will it break apart? So it's the first. And asteroids are a real threat.
Not all space hazards are natural. Some are man-made, right? And the International Space Station had a potentially dangerous situation.
We did. The Russians did an anti-satellite test, which should be illegal. And by the way, the Americans have done the same thing, and so have the Chinese. But this one got a lot of publicity because what they do, if there's a satellite in orbit, they send up a missile from the ground and try to hit it, which is very hard to do because satellites are moving fast. They're moving almost 30,000 kilometers an hour. So you're trying to hit a bullet with a bullet, is what they're trying to say. So it's very difficult to do that. So they did. But the problem is that it made all the shrapnel that spread out, and it turned out that the dirt and the pieces that were left are in line with the International Space Station. And so the space station plowed through that stuff. The astronauts on board had to hide. They had to get into their capsules to get ready to leave in case it punctured a hole. Because again, the speeds are so high that even a small piece like that is a bullet. And by the way, the cannon arm that's on the space station right now has a hole in it. One of these pieces of debris actually hit the cannon arm. It didn't hurt it, but you can see there's a big hole in it right now. So that stuff can go right through. It can puncture the module, start air escaping and things like that. This, we need an international treaty. The spacefaring countries need to get together and make an agreement that we won't do that, and that will clean up the junk. There are more than 10,000 dead satellites orbiting the Earth right now, and they all pose a hazard as well. So if you're going to put something up in space, you should also be responsible for bringing it back down at the end of its life. So far, there are no agreements for that, and we need one.
Can we talk about China? I mean, I remember, you know, for years, most of my life, the ISS, even Mir, were the space stations right. That I knew of.
Sure.
China was not a player.
Absolutely.
Boy, has that changed.
And it's because the Americans don't want the Chinese to be part of the International Space Station because of political reasons. So China has decided on their own to have their own independent space program. And they've been doing some remarkable things even just this year. They also landed a rover on Mars. And it's driving around, and it had the ability to look underground, so it's doing geology on Mars. They landed a lander on the moon that scooped up some lunar dirt and brought it back to the Earth. We haven't had lunar samples since 1972, when the last astronauts went there. And they've got their own space station. And they've got three astronauts up there right now. They call them taikonauts. But they're up on their own space station right now. They've done spacewalks. I was just watching a video. They were doing lessons to school children from space, playing with blobs of water in space and showing how things behave differently in zero gravity. And they have their sights on the moon. So you watch. They're sort of in the background doing their own thing. We don't hear about it much here in the West. But I wouldn't be all too surprised if the next flag to be planted on the moon is a red one.
Because the way things are going, you can't help but wonder if this is kind of a new space race, similar in a way to the ones that
yes,
we've seen.
And if they were, if they announced that they had a mission to the moon, a manned mission to the moon, you can bet that the Americans will be speeding up their plan to get someone there first. So maybe that would be a good thing, you know, push it ahead.